نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد Brothers and sisters in Islam, the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the deen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala completed his favor upon his creation, it emphasizes the acquisition of sound knowledge in theory, practice, and education. Knowledge, brothers and sisters, is a supreme value that governs every single facet of the life of the believer, whether intellectually, domestically, spiritually, or otherwise. No religion in the world has placed knowledge at the center or at the forefront of every act of worship or every act of religious devotion like the religion of Al-Islam. Every chapter and every verse in the Quran is saturated with emphasis and stress laid on the importance of knowledge. From parables, commandments, narratives of nations of old who failed to act upon knowledge, as well as the mention of many lofty names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that denote and accentuate the importance of knowledge. The first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in this creation was the tool by which man was to learn knowledge, and that was the pen. قَدْ أَخْرَجَ الْتِرْمِذِي وَأَبُو دَاوُودَ عَنْ عُبَادَةَ بْنِ صَامِتَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ قَالَ قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أول ما خلق الله القلم فقال له اكتب فقال القلم يا ربي ما اكتب فقال الله جل وعلا اكتب ما هو كائن إلى يوم القيامة The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned in this authentic hadith that the first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created was the pen. And then he commanded the pen, Uktub, write. The pen asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and what shall I write? وَلَيْسَ بِعَجَبٍ And it's not something amazing that a pen can talk. فَأَنْتَقَنَ اللَّهُ الَّذِي أَنْتَقَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can make anything that he wants to speak. جَلَّ وَعَالَ فَعَالُ لِمَا يُرِيدٍ He does whatever he will, subhanahu wa ta'ala. La yus'alu amma yaf'alu wa hum yus'alun. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not to be questioned about what he does, but you will be questioned about what you do. The pen asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what shall I write? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed the pen to write everything that was to take place in this life up until the day of judgment. Qala Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullahu ta'ala, فَهَذَا الْقَلَمْ خَلَقَهُ اللَّهُ جَلَّ وَعَلَى لَمَّا أَمَرَهُ بِالتَّقْدِيرَ الْمَكْتُوبِ قَبْلَ خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ 50,000 years Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala He created this pen when he wanted the pen to write down the divine decree. And he created this pen before the creation of the heavens and the earth, 50,000 years. He said, وَهُوَ أَوَّلُ خَلْقٍ وَهُوَ أَوَّلُ مَا خُلِقَ مِنْ هَذَا الْعَالَمِ وَخَلَقَهُ بَعْدَ الْعَرْشِ كَمَا دَلَتْ عَلَيْهِ النُّصُوصِ وَهُوَ قَوْلُ جَمْهُورِ السَّلَفِ انْتَهَى كَلَامُهُ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he continued by saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this pen, and it was the first of creation in this world. However, before the creation of the pen, there was the creation of the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which was actually the first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created, as it was indicated by many textual evidences in the Quran and the Sunnah, as well as the statement or the opinion by the vast majority of the scholars of the past. قال ابن القيم رحمه الله تعالى أنه سبحانه وتعالى لما افتتح خلق هذا العالم بالقلم كان من أحسن المناسبة أن يختمه بخلق الإنسان فإن القلم آلة العلم والإنسان هو العالم ولهذا أظهر الله سبحانه وتعالى فضل آدم على الملائكة بالعلم الذي خص به. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he began creation, he began the creation of this world with the pen. So it was only appropriate that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the last thing that he created be the human being. Because the pen is the tool by which knowledge is sought. And the human being, he is the only beneficiary of knowledge. Animals don't understand knowledge. They act on instinct, not intellect. And that is why when the human being is reduced to an animal by acting upon his impulse instead of intellect, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, that he created the human being أحسن التقويم, in the best of molds. ثُمَّ رَدَدْنَاهُ إِلَىٰ أَسْفَلَ السَّافِلِينَ. And then we reduce him to being the lowliest of creation. When you fail to act upon the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you to inherit and to be the beneficiary of. He says, so if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the pen, the first thing he created was the pen, it was only appropriate that the last thing that he created be the human being who was to be the beneficiary of the pen. Because it is through the pen that knowledge is sought. And the human being, he is the only one that can benefit from knowledge. And as a result of this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala displayed or showed the virtue of Adam over the rest of creation, including the angels, through knowledge. It wasn't through his physical being, as Iblis asserted. Iblis said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he questioned him about why he didn't prostrate to Adam, he said, because I'm better than him. You created me physically from fire and you created him from dirt. This was Shaitan's outlook, failing to see that the overall objective was to look at deeper than the physical being, which was the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَى كُلَّهَا ثُمَّ عَرَضَهُمَ عَلَى الْمَلَائِكَةِ فَقَالَ أَنْبِئُونِي بِأَسْمَاءِ هَؤُلَاءِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught Adam the names of everything. Then he told Adam to go over to the angels and present those names or that knowledge to the angels and see what their reply is. And the angels said that we have no knowledge of this. And this was the virtue that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Adam over the rest of creation. However, Shaytan, much like every other individual that Shaytan takes advantage of, they tend to look very shallowly at the surface. Many times we'll look at one another and we'll say, I have more money than you, that means I'm better. I have more wealth than you, that means I'm better. I have more children than you, that means I'm better. My wife looks better than you, that means I'm better. I drive a nice car than you, I make six figures. And all of these other superficial gauges that we use to determine our virtue over another individual. But the true virtue in this deen right here is with knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, يرفع الله الذين آمنوا والذين يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات والله بما تعملون خبير. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that He will raise those from amongst you who have been given true iman, those from amongst you who truly believe, and those from amongst you who have been granted knowledge. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is well aware of everything that you do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the exaltation of the people of knowledge in four different places in the Quran. وَقَدْ ثَبَتَ فِي صَحِيْ مُسْلِمْ مِنْ حَدِيثِ الزُّهْرِي عن أبي طفيل بن نافع طفيل بن أن النافع ابن حارث أتى عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله تعالى عنه بأسعان وكان عمر استعمله على مكة فقال له عمر من استخلفت على أهل الوادي فقال استخلفت عليهم ابن أبزة فقال عمر من ابن أبزة فقال رجل من موالينا فقال عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه استخلفت عليهم مولى فقال إنه والله قارئ لكتاب الله عالم بالفرائد فقال عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه أما إن نبيكم قد قال إن الله يرفع بهذا الكتاب أقواما ويضع به الآخرين. On the authority of Abu Tufail, that Nafi ibn Harith, he came to Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu in an area by the name of Usman. And Umar used to use him and place him as a governor over Mecca. So Umar asked him, as he came to Medina, Umar asked him, then who did you leave to be a governor over the people of this particular valley? So he said, I left a man by the name of Ibn Abza as a governor to watch over the people. Umar said, Man Ibn Abza, who is this Ibn Abza? And so he said to Umar, he is one of our main servants. He is one of our male servants, one of our slaves. Umar said, are you telling me that you left a slave to govern the people? He said to Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, I swear by Allah, he is the most knowledgeable person as it relates to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The most knowledgeable person of the obligations of the religion. Has nothing to do with his social status, has everything to do with his knowledge of the deen. And Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, I guess so, because indeed your messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say that indeed Allah will raise with this book, meaning the Quran, and he will humiliate others. He will raise with this book some people and he will humiliate with this book other people. Knowledge, brothers and sisters, was the bedrock of the social development of the first community of Islam, which paved the way for the spiritual maturation of the believers in relation to the religious boundaries that have been set by the Sharia. The first revelation given to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the commandment to read. Make the connections, brothers and sisters. The first thing Allah created was the pen. The first revelation given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was iqra, was read. قال ابن قيم رحمه الله تعالى إن أول سورة أنزل الله في كتابه سورة القلم سماه القلم فذكر فيها من ما من به على الإنسان من تعليمه ما لم يعلم فذكر فيها فضله بتعليمه وتفضيله الإنسان بما علمه إياه وذلك يدل على شرف التعليم والعلم انتهى كلامه رحمه الله تعالى. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that the first surah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in Surah Al-Qalam, this surah was not revealed in its complete totality. The first ayats that was revealed were five, and then there were seven ayats revealed from another surah. There were whole surahs revealed. So when he says the first surah that was revealed, he's talking about the ayats in the surah, not the surah in its totality. The first ayahs that were revealed was the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to read. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in these verses in Surah Al-Qalam that that he taught the human being that which he had no knowledge of. And here, it must be a mistake or error here, because it's Surah Al-Alaq, not Surah Al-Qalam. But he taught the human being that which he had no knowledge of by the pen. So when we fast forward to today, brothers and sisters, because our biggest fitna, our biggest trial today as Muslims is not living 1434 years ago. I think we do a pretty decent job of that in our minds. In our minds, we live a picture book version of Islam 1434 years ago. That's not the intent. The Quran was revealed to be relevant all the way up until Yawm al-Qiyamah. We don't have to go backwards to make the Quran and Islam relevant. Quran and Islam is relevant in any time, any place, under any circumstances. Our fitna is learning how to take the knowledge of 1434 years ago and make it relevant today. That is our fitna. Fast forward to today, where many Muslims totally disregard the importance of knowledge, totally disregard the necessity of knowledge unless it is circumstantially compelling and unavoidable. It is a wonder that we have very little success in our personal lives, in our personal endeavors, as well as in our spiritual lives and in our religious endeavors. How can we expect, brothers and sisters, to have any good fortune or to have any success when the vast majority of our endeavors are pursued based upon ignorance and based upon instant gratification satisfying our desires? How can we expect success when the vast majority of the things that we do is simply based upon ignorance? Look at many of the brothers and sisters who rush out to go get married and have absolutely no clue what it means to be a Muslim husband or a Muslim wife. Evidenced by the many visits and the frequent trips to the Imam's office for counseling sessions simply because we didn't take the time out to prepare ourselves. Proper preparation prevents poor performance, brothers and sisters. And that is applicable in every aspect of our lives. Qala Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, al-jahlu da'un qatilun wa shifa'uhu amrani fi at-tarkib muttafiqani. Nassu min al-Qur'ani aw min sunnatin wa tabibu dhaka 'alim al-rabbani. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned in this line of poetry that jahl, ignorance, is an infectious disease, and the only cure for it is two things that have to be combined one with the other. A text from the Quran, and a text from the Sunnah, and a scholar, someone who is knowledgeable enough to clarify to you what is in it, a benefit for you in your life. This is the only cure for ignorance, brothers and sisters. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his tawfiq, for his success, and all of our endeavors. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعني وإياكم بما جاء فيه من الآيات والذكر الحكيم أقول ما تسمعون أستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المؤمنين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله العلي الجبار غافر الذنب وقابل التوب شديد العقاب وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. Brothers and sisters, the acquisition and digestion of knowledge, both religiously and secularly, is what gave birth to the academic culture or cultivation that was necessary or paramount to the creation of an environment of communal cohesion and mutual respect for the quality of life that the religion of Al-Islam proposed to its adherents. During the second year after the Hijrah, one of the greatest battles in the history of Al-Islam was fought, the Battle of Badr. This was a milestone in the triumph of Islam and the believers, and it left a profound impact on the legacy of Islam even up until the moment that I utter these very words. After the Battle of Badr, The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam consulted his companions, namely Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, concerning the captives of war that they had that belonged to Quraysh, 70 of them in total. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked Umar, what should we do with these captives? Umar said that we should kill every single one of them. You should give Aqil to Ali, who was his brother, and let him cut his head off. Give Fulan to Fulan and let him kill him. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, rahmatan lil alameen, a mercy to all of mankind. There's no way that he would opt for such a suggestion. So he went to Abu Bakr and he asked Abu Bakr, what should we do with these captives? Listen to what Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, a leader in his own right, even before he became a leader. He said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that our objective here is not to humiliate or to emasculate anyone. So any one of them who has the money to purchase his own freedom, then let him do so. We don't want to take your manhood from you. We don't want to make you less of a human being. We still want you to keep your dignity. So if you have money to purchase your freedom, then let them do so. He said, as for those who do not have the money or the wherewithal to purchase their freedom, then let them earn their freedom by teaching 10 Muslims how to read and write. Let him earn his freedom by teaching 10 Muslims how to read and how to write. And this gives you a glimpse into the mentality of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Today we have lost sight, brothers and sisters, of this, unfortunately. And thus we have created a climate of dysfunction and intolerance that tends to push people away from the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But rather push people away from the religion of Al-Islam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he warned us about these type of times. The type of times where ignorance becomes so prevalent, you almost don't want to come out of your home. You don't want to go to the masjid. You don't want to intermingle with the believers. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, اتنروا بالمعروف وتناهوا عن المنكر حتى إذا رأيت شح المطاع وهو المتبع والدنيا مؤثرة وإعجاب كل ذي رأي برأيه فعليك بخاصة نفسك ودع عنك الأوام فإن من ورائكم أيام الصبر إلى آخر الحديث. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, continue to enjoin what is good and forbid what is evil until you see shuh and muta', until you see people giving way to their greed and to their fear of stingy, to their fear of being poor. They become driven by their fear of poverty. Shuh and muta', they begin to obey their desire and their fear for being poor. وَهَوَ الْمُتَّبَعُ, and people begin to start following their desires. We don't care about halal and haram anymore. And you start to see people giving precedence over the dunya. Giving precedence to the dunya over the deen. You haven't seen a brother in 4 or 5 jumu'ahs. You say, Salaam alaikum, brother, where have you been? Oh, mashallah, I'm working overtime now. Where's working overtime for the deen? Where's working overtime for your hereafter? The life in this world is very short, and you work overtime for something that is fanny, something that is quick passing. And you don't work any overtime for the perpetual life in the hereafter. أَتَسْتَبْدِلُونَ الَّذِي هُوَ أَدْنَى بِالَّذِي هُوَ خَيْرٌ. Do you trade in that which is less than for that which is superior? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked the question in the Quran. How do we work overtime for a short period of time in this life, and we work no overtime for the hereafter, which is the true home? As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَإِنَّ الْآخِرَةِ لَهِيَ الْحَيَوَانِ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. That the hereafter, it is the true life, if you only knew. But we work overtime for this life. Overtime for a house that is not going to benefit us anything. Overtime for a car, overtime for family and children that we're going to run away from on the day of judgment. يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ مَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ يَوْمَئِذٍ شَأْنٌ يُغْنِيهِ. On a day where a man will run away from his mother and his father, he will run away from his own companions. Because every soul on that day will have enough to worry about than to be worried about someone else. A father will turn to his son on the day of judgment and say, "Wasn't I a good father to you? Give me some of your good deeds." A son will turn to his mother and say, "Wasn't I a good son to you? Give me some of your good deeds." We work overtime for this, and we don't work do any overtime for the hereafter. But when you start to see people giving precedence to the dunya over the deen, وَإِعْجَابْ كُلِّ ذِي رَأْيٍ بِرَأْيِ, and everyone is pleased and satisfied with his own opinions. Everybody has an opinion today. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. أَجْهَلُ مِنْ هِمَارِ أَهْلِ, the most ignorant of individuals, and he has an opinion on every single thing. Generations of scholars have come and gone and debated on issues, some of which scholars have made tawakuf. They have never even taken an opinion on the issue because the issue was so extensive that it would have taken them a lifetime to study and to gain an opinion on it. Today we give opinions on it with no dalil, no understanding, no knowledge, no formal study of Islam, but we have an opinion. You start to see people being pleased with their opinions. He said, then tend to yourself. فَعَلَيْكَ بِخَاسَةِ نَفْسِكَ, tend to yourself with دَعَمْكَ الْأَوَامِ, and stay away from the general body or the general masses of the people, for indeed behind you are many days that you are going to have to be patient. And I'm not advocating this, I'm just simply clarifying that we are moving very quickly into those times due to the lack of knowledge. Today we are faced with a great dilemma, brothers and sisters, that seems to haunt every generation, and that is the disease of irq, the disease of jahl, of ignorance. قال ابن قيم رحمه الله تعالى, كل ما في القرآن من مدح العبد فهو من ثمرة العلم, وكل ما في القرآن من ذم العبد فهو من ثمرة الجهل. ابن قيم رحمه الله تعالى said that every time you see that a servant is praised for something in the Quran, it is the end result of knowledge. Every person or every individual that you see Allah praising in the Quran, it is the end result somewhere of knowledge. And every individual that you see being blamed or condemned in the Quran, it is due to ignorance in some shape, form, or fashion. Today, ignorance, brothers and sisters, is a little more sophisticated than it was yesterday. Today, ignorance is clothed in technology, such as the smartphone, the smart water, the smart car, smart etc., etc., that does all the thinking for us, mashallah, tabarakallah, leaving you bereft of basic common sense and the ability to critically analyze the things that confront you in your life. Ignorance, brothers and sisters, is clothed in music, clothed in fashion, clothed in the various social medias, Facebook and all of these other social media outlets. You look at the stuff that people post, it is pure, unadulterated ignorance. Ignorance, brothers and sisters, is clothed in subliminal messages that tap into our subconscious, causing us to react or act in impulsive ways resembling that of animals, which creates some of the most detrimental and unfavorable circumstances and outcomes for us, our families, and our communities. Ignorance, brothers and sisters, is such a loathsome quality that even a person that deserves to be called ignorant is offended when you call him ignorant. And he deserves the quality of ignorance. Listen to what Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, كَفَى بِالْعِلْمِ شَرَفَى أن يدعيه من ليس بأهلي وكفى بالجهل ذما يعني عيبا أن يتبرأ منه من هو فيه. Ali ibn Abi Talib رضي الله تعالى عنه, he said that it is sufficient for knowledge to be a praiseworthy quality that even people who are not knowledgeable would love to be called knowledgeable. Even people who are not knowledgeable would love to be called knowledgeable. That is to show you how praiseworthy this quality is. He said, and it is sufficient for ignorance to be a condemned quality, to be an embarrassing quality, to be a loathsome quality that even the person who is ignorant hates to be called ignorant. He tries to remove himself from a realm where he would be considered ignorant, even though he is ignorant. Brothers and sisters, it is imperative that we uphold and maintain this profound legacy in our deen of knowledge and education. If we desire the authority and superiority that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised us. قال عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه تعلموا العلم فإن تعلمه خشية وطلبه عبادة ودراسته تسبيح والبحث عنه جهاد وتعليمه لمن لا يعلم صدقة وبذله لأهله قربة وهو أنس في وحدة وهو صاحب في الخلوة. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, seek knowledge. Ta'allamu al-'ilm, learn knowledge, educate yourself. He said, because knowledge, it is khashya, it develops a fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And seeking knowledge is ibadah, it is worship. And studying knowledge is a form of praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And going out in search for knowledge is jihad. Going out in search for knowledge is jihad. And teaching knowledge to someone who doesn't know is a sadaqah. It is a charity. And to give knowledge to your family, it is a qurbah, it is a good deed that will bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And knowledge is the one thing that will never leave you when you are in times of despair and when you are alone by yourself. Knowledge will always be there. And lastly, brothers and sisters, we have to learn how to pay zakat on our knowledge. That when we learn, we don't learn for the sake of saying, I know. Many of us, subhanAllah, if you were to get in a conversation and begin a hadith, we would complete the hadith for you. But then when you look at how much of that hadith that we practice and that we implement, brothers and sisters, we will be accountable for every hadith, every ayah, every piece of knowledge that we know about this deen, we will be accountable for it. قال بشر الحافي أدوا زكاة الحديث فاستعملوا كل مئتي حديث خمسة أحاديث. One of the Salaf, the scholars of the past, he said, pay zakat on your hadith. Pay zakat on your hadith. He said, out of every 200 hadith that you learn, then you need to act upon at least 5 of them. Out of 200, 5. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, مَا عَلِمْتُ حَدِيثًا إِلَّا وَعَمِلْتُ بِهِ وَلَوْ مَرَّةً وَاحِدًا لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ حُجَّةً عَلَيَّ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, I never memorized the hadith except that I acted upon it, even if it was one time. Even if it was just one time. So that the hadith would not be a proof against me on the day of judgment. I acted upon it at least just one time. So at least before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm free of blame. Abu Darda radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, أَخْوَفُ مَا أَخَافُ عَلَى نَفْسِي أَنْ أَقِفْ بَيْنِ يَدَيِّ اللَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ فَيَسْأَلُنِي هَلْ تَعَلَمْتْ فَأَقُولُ نَعَمْ فَيَقُولُ رَبِّي فَيَقُولُ رَبِّي وَمَاذَا عَمِلْتَ بِمَا تَعَلَمْتْ. Abu Darda radiallahu ta'ala anhu, one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the thing that I fear for myself is that on the day of judgment, I stand before Allah and He asks me, did you learn? And I say, yes. And then Allah asks me, what did you do with what you learned? What did you act upon from what you learned? قال عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه كان الرجل منا تعلم عشر آيات من كتاب الله لم يجاوزهن حتى يعرف ما في معانيها ما فيها من معانيها وعلو الحكم ويعمل بهن. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, giving us a glimpse into the methodology of the Sahaba as it relates to the Quran. He said that during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there would be a man from amongst us who would learn only 10 verses from the Quran, and he would not go past those 10 verses until he learned what they meant he learned what was in those verses of wisdom and knowledge, and then he acted upon those 10 verses before he would move on to the next. It took Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, some scholars say 11 years, some say 13 years, to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah. While many of our children memorize it in 6 months, in 3 months, but how much of it do they act upon? Our focus should not be on quantity, it should be on quality. It should be no concern how much, but it should be the quality of what we learn and what we act upon. قال إمام الذهبي رحمه الله تعالى في الختام أما اليوم فما بقي من العلوم القليلة إلا قليل في أناس قليل ما أقل من يعمل منهم بذلك القليل فحسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل. إمام الذهبي رحمه الله تعالى, he said today there's only just a little bit of knowledge left. من العلوم القليلة إلا قليل. He said, from amongst a little bit of knowledge that reached us, only a portion of that remains. And of that small portion of knowledge, there's only a small group of people that understand that knowledge. And of those that understand the knowledge, there's only a small group of them that actually act upon the knowledge. Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel. Sufficient is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a wakeel, as a guardian over us. Brothers and sisters, please learn your deen. For those of us who are newly converts to the religion of Al-Islam, the only independence that you will gain is when you learn this deen. Every Muslim that you run into is going to give you a different version of how to practice your deen. The only way that you eliminate all of these different versions and practices of Islam, what you should do, what you shouldn't be doing, is by sitting down and learning the religion for yourself. Learn the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, brothers and sisters, and make yourself independent of other individuals. We will always be dependent on knowledge, but we can eliminate our dependence on other individuals when we learn the deen for ourselves. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنًا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنًا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. اللهم إنا نسألك العلم نافعا. Oh Allah, we ask you for beneficial knowledge. ورزقا طيبا. We ask you for halal provision. وعملا صالحا متقبلا. And we ask you for righteous deeds that you will accept from us subhanahu wa ta'ala. ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على قوم الكافرين. اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. وسبحانك ربك رب العزة عما يصفون. وسلام على المرسلين. والحمد لله رب العالمين. وأقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر, الله أكبر, الله أكبر, الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة, حي على الصلاة. حي على الفلاح, حي على الفلاح. قد قامت الصلاة, قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر, الله أكبر. لا إله إلا الله.
استووا, استووا صفوفكم تراصوا. Brothers and sisters, inshallah ta'ala, we would like to, before we begin the prayer, just to remind everyone that there is a academic conference that is going on this weekend at the Marriott, not too far from here. Inshallah ta'ala, after the prayer, inshallah, if you need more information about that, we will give you the information, but we encourage everyone to, at least for one day, to come by and stop by. You never know where your success is gonna come from. Don't ever underestimate where your success is gonna come from. You could hear a word in passing, and it saved your life.
You could hear a hadith that you never heard before, and you act upon it, and it saves you from the hellfire. Never underestimate. Much like when we eat food, we are to eat and clean the plate because we never know where the blessing of the food is. Likewise, when it comes to knowledge, don't ever underestimate where your success and your prosperity is going to come from.
Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim Maliki Yawm al-Din. Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'in. Ihdina الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. يسبح لله ما في السماوات وما في الأرض الملك القدوس العزيز الحكيم. هو الذي بعث في الأمين رسولا منهم يتلون عليهم آياتي ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين. وآخرين منهم لما يلحقوا بهم وهو العزيز الحكيم. ذلك فضل الله يؤتيه من يشاء والله ذو الفضل العظيم. مثل الذين حملوا التوراة ثم لم يحملوها كمثل الحمار يحمل أسفارا بئس مثل القوم الذين كذبوا بآيات الله والله لا يهدي القوم الظالمين. قل يا أيها الذين هادوا إن زعمتم أنكم أولياء لله فتمنوا الموت إن كنتم صادقين. ولا يتمنونه أبدا بما قدمت أيديهم والله عليم بالظالمين. قل إن الموت الذي تفرون منه فإنه ملاقيكم ثم تردون إلى عالم الغيب والشهادة فينبئكم بما كنتم تعملون. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده.
Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Maliki Yawm Al-Din. Iyaka Na'budu Wa Iyaka Nasta'in. Ihdina الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا نودي للصلاة يوم الجمعة فاسعوا إلى ذكر الله وذروا البيع ذلكم خير لكم إن كنتم تعلمون. وإذا قضيت الصلاة فانتشروا في الأرض وابتغوا من فضل الله واذكروا الله كثيرا لعلكم تفلحون. وإذا رأوا تجارة أو لهوا انفضوا إليها وتركوك قائما. قل ما عند الله خير من اللهو ومن التجارة والله خير الرازقين. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. As-salamu